Thank you for inviting me, Roland, and thank you all for being here. Delighted to be here, although it's true that I only just made the plane with 5 minutes because the lines were extraordinary. So my talk today is on the Euro crisis of governance, and I'm really going to be focusing on legitimacy. My talk is not going to focus on the economics, although I'm very happy to speak about that later, and you'll see that the economics, of course, is very much behind this. But I know you've had other speakers focused much more on the economic issues and the policy issues. And what I want to do is actually bring in the politics and also to do some theorizing about how do you explain institutional change and how does one understand legitimacy? And how does one theorize about legitimacy in the midst of the crisis? And also taking the actors themselves seriously and asking how they themselves think about their legitimacy during the crisis and how they then go about changing, actually changing the way in which they act as a result of problems with the economics and with the politics. Rise of the extremes on the right with the politics and, of course, the economics deteriorating. So what's the problem? This, you know, the Eurozone crisis is not only a crisis of economics, it's also a crisis of politics and democracy across Europe. So what about crisis governance? As you all know, after some delay, EU leaders agreed to loan bailout mechanisms in exchange for reinforcing the stability rules and the numerical targets of the Stability and Growth Pact. In the absence of deeper political integration, of democratic representation or control, in the face of divided preferences amongst the member states over what to do and how to do it, as a result of institutional constraints, unanimity rule being obviously a major one, and legal obstacles, constant fear that by the ECB that it would be taken to court, to the European Court of Justice, or to the German Constitutional Court, made it very difficult to find any way, anything to do. And what happens then, after much delay, what you get is a reinforcement of the rules. We end up seeing governing by the rules and ruling by the numbers, as I like to call it. But importantly, as the crisis evolves from 2011 to 2014, we can talk about what happens later in starting in 2015, but as a result of deteriorating economics, and increasingly toxic politics, populist right, extremes on the right in particular, also on the left, what you get is a reinterpretation of the rules and a recalibration of the numbers by stealth. What I mean by this is that at the same time you get increasing flexibility, reinterpretations of what it is they're doing, they don't admit it in the communicative discourse to the general public. Instead, what you get is a discourse of we're sticking by the rules, whether it's the European Central Bank, whether it's the Council, with Merkel saying it's all about stability, even as she agrees to changes. It's the Commission, with Olli Rehn, who has a very harsh austerity discourse and structural reform, even as he agrees to increasing flexibility, to derogations. Basically, it's about what you get is recognition, the rules aren't working, we've got to do something. They start recalibrating the numbers, altering the rules, but no one's admitting it. I suppose one could call this lying, but we won't. So what are the theoretical questions that this raises? And it's basically, one is how do we explain change, these slow incremental changes over time that you see, and how to legitimate change. So how you explain reinterpreting the rules by stealth in terms of institutional change and legitimacy, first we need methodological theory about institutional change. And not here, but in a variety of papers, even here I'll talk about this a bit. In terms of a methodological theory about how you explain institutional change, I combine historical institutionalism, I like to call this revisionist historical institutionalism. This is Kathy Thielen and Wolfgang Streich or Mahoney and Streich, who essentially focus on incremental change, slow changes, layering, drift, conversion, reinterpretation. And I use that to talk about the kinds of moderations in policy over time, but they tend to describe the changes rather than explain them. And what I do is then move to what I call discursive institutionalism, which focuses on the agents of change, if you will, and their changing ideas about what to do. But in this case, what we see is they have a set of ideas about what to do, a discourse that denies what their ideas are, but actions that actually reflect what their ideas are. So it's a discursive institutionalism that says the discourse is all about hiding what you're doing and persuading that that's fine without saying what you're doing. But you'll see. And later on, toward the at the end of my presentation, I will again come back to the methodological theoretical issues. But right now, we're going to be focusing on the normative theory regarding legitimacy. And here, there's a big question: how do you talk about legitimacy? I'm going to take the way in which the EU studies literature does it, which is systems. I'm sure that most of you hate Easton. But regardless, this is the language of EU. I'm not sure that you do, but anyway. The language of EU studies is essentially focused on David Easton. It's Fritz Scharf picking up on that. Input and output. Policy results, output, political responsiveness, input, and then the quality of the governance process, sort of a term that I brought back, which we call throughput. And if we want to talk about how you think about EU democratic legitimacy, first is output legitimacy. This is policies for the people. This very much is Fritz Scharf in his 1999 piece, but also earlier. It's policies for the people. It's about the common good, performance, effectiveness of the policies. Input legitimacy is politics by the people. This is about the will of the people, citizen representation, participation, government responsiveness. And here, if you think about this, input legitimacy is what often is called political legitimacy, democratic legitimacy. Output legitimacy is sometimes simply talked about effectiveness, performance of the policies. But it's important to see that the two are actually interrelated. And often people talk about if you have a lot of good output, good policies, then even if the people don't have any kind of input, any say, it's okay. They accept it as legitimate. And similarly, you can have really stupid policies that don't work, but the people liked it, they voted for it, so it's still legitimate. And so important to see that there's a kind of trade-off that people assume works in democratic polities. But then what about throughput? And I sort of came up with this term recently, and a few other people, mainly German scholars, use it, but not in this way. I came up with it in 2010 when I was in Germany, actually. It's that input into the black box of governance, output in terms of policies. But what is it that goes on in that black box of governance? And if you think about the kinds of the work on public administration and legitimacy, the work on regulatory policy, there's a whole range of other words that are used that never get put together. Accountability, transparency. Think about all the language, not only of the EU Commission, but national regulatory agencies. It's all about, oh, we need to be accountable. It's about efficacy, of course. Got to do it well. It's about transparency, accessibility, inclusiveness. So it's about bringing in interest groups, organized interests, into the policymaking process. And all of this, I put in the term throughput, in order then to be able to say, okay, how does it sit against input and output? And one often assumes, oh, well, there must be trade-offs there too, input, output, throughput, but no, there is no trade-off. I think that's important, whereas input and output can trade off. Not always, obviously. There is no trade off. If you have good throughput, sorry, I've got a typo there. If you've got good throughput, it's basically washes out. Essentially, if civil servants do the right thing, they're transparent, they're accountable, the public doesn't even see it. But if the policy processes are oppressive, biased, corrupt, they can skew the input and they can taint the output. So I think there is no trade-off, but throughput is important in terms of when it works, or rather when it doesn't work. Okay, so what's the problem in terms of the Eurozone crisis? Basically, at the outset of the crisis, EU actors, all of them think, oh look, all we have to do is double down on the rules, govern by the rules, you know, governing by the rules, ruling by the numbers, and everything will be fine. That throughput legitimacy is sufficient to produce good output, and therefore it doesn't matter about input. And I think that's really key. But as we see, as the crisis continues, there's a recognition throughput's not enough. As we need better policies, output, especially, and we can see the results, the input politics is getting bad. Okay, so I'm going to take a hiatus before I go into the empirics, and what I'll do is talk about the ECB, the Council, I'll do this very quickly, ECB, Council, Commission, and Parliament. But before I do that, I want to look more closely into these different kinds of ways of thinking about legitimacy, because I think that's useful. So when we think about output and effectiveness and performance, there are two kinds of output legitimacy for crisis actors. There's technical output legitimacy. So here we're talking about policy, about the effectiveness and performance of the policies. And so when you're talking about the European Central Bank or the Commission, it's about expert assessments. There's an assumption that you are output legitimate if you've got good, you know, solid, empirical, scientific studies based on scientific principles. They're cognitive arguments. Your weapons are charts and graphs, mathematical calculations. This is all about economists, of course. And there's a coordinative discourse amongst policy experts, in particular in this non-majoritarian set of non-majoritarian institutions. They legitimate a particular policy based on what they're saying about how well the performance is going to work, and it's all about sort of expert analysis. On the political side, here we're talking about member state leaders in the Council and members of the European Parliament. Here, when they think about output legitimacy, whether these policies are legitimate, they ask, do these resonate with citizen values, with community norms? And they present a series of normative arguments. This is about principles of distributive justice, about fairness, about equity. Here's how you legitimate these policies. And of course, how do they develop this? It's in a communicative discourse with the public. It's about discussions related to public opinion, et cetera. So that's how the crisis actors conceive of legitimacy. But what about the effectiveness of these of the ideas? And here, you know, what are the ideas? You know, how do you think about the output policies themselves? And here, it's about ordo-liberalism. It's about neoliberalism, the Brussels-Frankfurt consensus on stability rules. So it's the Commission, the European Central Bank, and Berlin, of course. So ordo-liberalism focused on sound money, stable finance, neoliberalism in terms of what you need is structural reform, read smash the unions. And what we see is a debate based on this, and I'm sure you've heard it from previous speakers, scholars. Whereas the Brussels-Frankfurt consensus is, you know, the idea is what ideas are effective, it's ordo-liberal, it's neoliberal. What you get are from economists and political economists, scholars, they basically say it's a failure in framing, it's the misframing of the crisis as one of public debt, with the exception of Greece, rather than private debt. It's a misdiagnosis of the crisis is resulting from behavior, the wrong behavior, i.e. people spend too much, overspending, as opposed to structural, i.e. the very structure of the euro that has led to increasing divergence rather than convergence. It's the choice of remedies, i.e. austerity, structural reform, rather than stimulus, a neo-Keynesian approach, and the lack of solutions. No European Monetary Fund, no euro bonds, etc. No investment, etc. So there is controversy over on what constitutes effective ideas for output. And then, of course, what we know are the policy results are macroeconomic divergence, increasing differences between surplus and deficit countries, no growth, rise, here's the social policy, rise in unemployment, massive rise in unemployment, especially in the periphery, increasing levels of poverty. We can mention Ireland, we can mention Spain, which apparently is at 20% right now. And you can see this in all of the various reports of the Council of Europe, Caritas, the European Parliament. They're all talking about a humanitarian crisis across Europe, in particular in Southern Europe and in Central and Eastern Europe. Okay, so what I've given you here are three different ways in which one needs to think about legitimacy in terms of the policies. It also gives me an opportunity to talk about the economics without actually appearing to talk about economics. But it's essentially, it's how do the actors themselves judge what is legitimate and how do they think about legitimacy? What are the actual ideas about legitimacy? And here you get a split between the actors themselves and scholars or policy analysts. And then what are the results, which is, of course, at the basis of legitimacy is about performance. Not just what you think is effective, but then what happens, performance and problematic results. Okay, that's output. That's on the one side, that's about policies. But then we have to talk about input. That's about representation of the citizens, that's about responsiveness of governments to the citizens. And so it's interesting, at the EU level, you get the actors think of themselves in different ways in terms of input legitimacy. So it's the European Council, member states in the Council, and the European Parliament who claim input legitimacy. Okay, we represent the people. The member state leaders in the Council say we represent, you know, we are the indirect representatives of the people, and you had Sarkozy who basically went around saying, you know, we are more democratic than anyone else because we represent the people. The problem, of course, with that is, and this Fritz Sharpe has made a strong argument about this, you can represent your own people and agree to vote on something that imposes on your own people. But when you're imposing structural reform and austerity on Portugal, then that is not legitimate. But that's the Council. And the European Parliament, of course, it claims to have, you know, the only direct legitimacy because it's elected. There are problems there too, obviously, because who knows who one's representative is for the European Parliament and who in this room actually voted. Well, you may be a maybe you did, but at a in the UK, what was the number? Yeah, no, UK, you didn't vote. Right, and who knows who's the representative? Okay, there's a real problem also with the representativeness of the European Parliament as a result. Levels of abstentionism when it's at 56%, 56.5%. Okay, and the ECB, of course, it doesn't claim any input, any real input legitimacy. It sees it as a trade-off. It's got output. It's a non-majoritarian institution. The Commission sees itself as having secondary input. It's the Council's agent, so it has to speak to the input-accountable agents. And in the European semester, it's really got no input. It's about output. legitimacy. And what about the national level? In a previous, in a book I wrote entitled Democracy in Europe, I talked about a real problem, a split between the EU and the national level, that at the EU level you have policy without politics, and the national level is politics without policy. As increasing numbers of decisions are taken at the EU level, politics, national politics, is emptied of substance. And that was a book that I wrote in 2006, before the crisis. Well, it's, if anything, worse today, as even more policies, in particular on the economics, have gone up to the EU level. And so the national level is the main locus of input legitimacy. Peter Mayer actually put it very nicely. The problem is one of, for party government, are you responsive to the people, or are you responsible in terms of implementing the policy? So it's another way of thinking about input and output. Do you privilege output, so we're going to be responsible and impose austerity and structural reform on the public, on the citizenry, whatever they think, as each government is elected saying we're not going to do this, and then when they get elected they actually say we will, Syriza being the most recent example, highly problematic. But if you're responsive, then of course you're not obeying the EU rules. So what happens, of course, is, and what we've seen increasingly in the EU, is that a cycling of national governments. Most governments are not reelected. There's an increasing loss of trust in both national governments and the EU. It's quite extraordinary when you see when the numbers loss of trust in government, a negative image of the EU, the renationalization of debates, and also a rise of xenophobia. This is Hans-Peter Krise et al. The rise of Euroscepticism on the right and the left, and even in the center. So you have some centrist parties, as in Finland, that are more Eurosceptics in the center parties than on the sides, although that's probably changed by now. And of course, the rise of the extremes, populism, right, left, and increasingly in the mainstream as well. I'm not going to go into this, but I'm happy to talk about this later. And what you see also is twin problems, that increasing technocracy, which does not believe in party government because politics is bad, politicians are all rent seekers, actually also fuels populism. So on the input side, serious problems with the EU. And what about throughput and the quality of the processes? So here's what I discussed before. EU institutional actors increasingly reinterpret the rules by stealth. There's increasing flexibility in response to bad output policy performance, and increasing volatility in terms of political input. But as I said, they don't admit it in the discourse. So what's the impact of that? In terms of output, in terms of the policies itself, it taints the public's perceptions of the policies. The actors who do one thing and say another appear bullheaded, they appear ideological. As they're pushing these particular, as they appear to be pushing these political, these particular policies. And on the input side, it skews the politics. It helps the rise of the populace. And it's very misleading. You know, when Olli Rehn keeps saying, it's all, if you read his blog, well, the blog that he used to keep, obviously he's no longer there, but it was austerity is wonderful and very good, and he keeps repeating this, and structural reform, that's all you need. Even when we ease up on austerity, it's structural reform, and it's structural reform, and it's structural reform. But even as you get derogations in the rules, first the French and then the Italians get an extra 2 years in order to reduce their deficits, and then the Spanish are told that they're not going to get off the hook. And the Spaniards say, no, but we have another way of calculating the structural deficit. You haven't taken in unemployment. Ah, says the commission, okay, we'll take that into account. And sure enough, the Spaniards get let off the hook. So you actually get derogations and increasing flexibility. And at the same time, there's this discourse saying there are no exceptions. Rapid deficit reduction, structural reform, smash the unions. Very misleading. And what happens is the Southern Europeans continue to feel oppressed even when they're accommodated. And the Northern Europeans, the Germans in particular, feel deceived. And that's where you get Schäuble constantly, castigating the commission for not doing what it's supposed to do. So throughput ends up, you get efficacy versus transparency. You know, better rules make them work better, but there's no transparency. And you also lose accountability and, of course, inclusiveness. There isn't any. But it's important to note that EU technical and political actors have different pathways to legitimation. So I've described the sort of these general categories of how to think about legitimacy to you, but you have to look at each of these actors differently. Political actors, as I've mentioned before, communicate with national constituencies. The technical actors coordinate via expert networks to gain innovative ideas and to legitimate them. So ECB, how can we think about the ECB? So I like to think about it as a hero on the one hand, monetary policy, and ogre on austerity and structural reform, because that's what it pushes in exchange for monetary for saving the euro. And it goes, as it goes from one size fits none rules to whatever it takes, in Draghi's famous words in July 2012. So how does the ECB think about legitimacy? It claims that what it's got is output legitimacy, but what the ECB and most of these supranational actors forget is at the national level, there's the legitimation of these kinds of technical actors because they're in the shadow of national politics. The members of the board are appointed by national politicians. They're often vetted. You know, they may be appointed by the government and okayed by the legislature, et cetera. And they remain in the shadow of national politics. The ECB is removed, in principle, from all such politics. But the ECB could have what you could call, and this is the, Paul Tucker discusses this, and when he's talking about the Bank of England, he talked about discursive accountability, where in the Bank of England, you have to go in front of Parliament, and they can, you know, ask you questions, and you have to respond, and they can sanction you, etc. Well, the ECB does have to go talk to the European Parliament, but there are no sanctions. It has to hear the European Parliament. It doesn't have to pay attention. And what you see is, for the ECB, legitimacy starts with a strict interpretation of the charter as throughput legitimacy. It's all about credibility. But what happens? In monetary policy, you go from a discourse of credibility. Jean-Claude Trichet starts out, we have to be credible, we're not going to talk to the political actors, and we're going to do as little as possible. We are going to engage in non-standard monetary policy, but minimal. And what you see is Draghi comes in, and you see a shift in the discourse. And here I'll show you, it's very interesting. There's the word use frequency by ECB President Mario Draghi. Whoops, sorry. And what you see is credibility is in the very beginning. I don't know if you can read this, but anyway, it's reasonably high, very beginning, and then it's the last one in these columns, and it's gone. And instead, stability gets higher and higher, and that's the fall 2012. And what you see, so I'll now go back. What you see is that the discourse of the ECB changes, and it goes from credibility to stability. And why stability? Because under stability, under the stability rules, it's about stability in the medium term. And once you say stability in the medium terms, in the medium term, then it's whatever it takes. Then you can go from non-standard policy to unorthodox policies. And you go from open monetary transactions all the way to quantitative easing. And that's what we see slowly but surely. Whatever it takes to becoming almost a lender of last resort. And this is a discursive process. I mean, I think the big question for us is, if you remember, there's a coalition supporting the Bundesbank in the initial phase of the crisis. The Bundesbank, Jens Weidmann says, you know, basically, you have to stick by the rules. Slowly but surely, the Finns and the Dutch leave Jens Weidmann on his own, and they all come behind Draghi. How do we explain that? Well, the story's yet to be told, but my hunch is, and we've got I'm in part of a Horizon 2020 project focus on these questions of legitimacy and how you build it. The untold story is basically an opening up of the expert networks, or opening up to expert networks, to the epistemic communities of central bankers, economists, etc. So you talk to the Fed, you talk to the Bank of England, and what you do is you develop new ideas about how you approach this, even as you legitimate those ideas to the other central bankers, so much so that you can end up isolating the Bundesbank. At the same time, in Draghi's very interesting that way, he's also a charm offensive with Merkel. That goes on for banking union over a year, and we can assume for all of the other things. Merkel essentially sides with Draghi against her own appointment to the German Central Bank. Leadership, of course, matters as well. Here, Trichet has a history of as a French administrator. I think he was Sciences Po and then National School of Administration, and he went through the Treasury and then becomes, you know, whereas Draghi's Goldman Sachs, but he was first an economist, professor of economist, Goldman Sachs, financier, banker, et cetera, and a firefighter. So I think that's important. But this is all ECB's hero. There's another side to the ECB. In exchange for doing all of these unorthodox policies, what you see is the ECB keeps saying, okay, I've done my bit. Now you, member state leaders, need to engage in austerity and structural reform. And that's why you get this almost Janus-faced view of the ECB. On the one hand, everyone loves the ECB because it's the only one that acted. And on the other hand, it's the ECB that's pushing the member states to engage in massive austerity, rapid deficit reduction, until it recognizes that actually that's a problem, in which case it backs off. And it's the first one to say to the member state leaders and the commission, well, actually, this may not be working. Focus on structural reform instead, and you get actually a shift in the discourse to structural reform. But the ECB is the ogre in terms of austerity and structural reform. And even, you know, at the moment of whatever it takes, it's lender of last resort with conditionality, so that Italy and Spain are going to be rescued only if they had agree to go into programs, presumably with the Troika, which of course they don't do, and they engage in basically implicit conditionality. They do it to themselves, which is always better. But so fiscal consolidation and structural reform are quid pro quo. And let's not talk about input legitimacy. Trichet writes letters to Zapatero in Spain. He writes them to Berlusconi, although we might agree with the Berlusconi letter, but not the Zapatero letter. But he did it to also a letter to Brian Linehan. Didn't that come out recently? Where it basically says, we we're pulling the plug, pulling the carpet out from under you, unless you agree to go into a massively painful austerity program. So that's the ECB. And I went on at length for the ECB. I'll be faster with the others. But I think the ECB is almost the most interesting case. Also because institutionally, the ECB's got autonomy. And it can create a discourse. So it really works on its communicative discourse to explain what it's doing. But it's still, you might ask, OK, where's the reinterpreting the rules by stealth? It's by stealth because it keeps saying the discourse is all about, we're sticking to our charter. We're not changing anything. This is the charter. But, you know, Trichet's account of the Charter, very narrow interpretation. 2009, he says, we can't be a lender of last resort. That's not us. That may be the Bank of England and the Fed, but we can't do it. By 2012, Draghi's also saying, Draghi quits mentioning lender of last resort. The markets assume, finally, the ECB has agreed that it's going to be lender of last resort. It doesn't say it. But what it does each time is say, oh, don't worry, be happy, we're in our mandate. I think this is tremendously important. Important to see how it's reinterpreting the rules by stealth, even as it engages in a very elaborate communicative discourse. I say this because very different for the Commission. Very different for the Commission. But before we get to the Commission, I want to give you the opposite side, is the Council. Oh, sorry. Future? Well, we'll talk about that later. Council. Okay, so is the Council a dictatorship or a deliberative body? If any of you are familiar with the EU studies literature lately, it's all about the new intergovernmentalism as a consensus-seeking deliberative body. Bit pie in the sky. Okay, governing by one-size-fits-one rules. Is it a dictator, a deliberative body? Okay, we've already talked about council legitimacy. And importantly, the member state leaders are not a representative forum, but rather a bargaining arena. But okay, so if we're going to say, if we're going to answer the question, is the council a dictatorship? Well, Germany. Dictator? German diktats in the council. Certainly, lots of people talk about the increasing intergovernmentalism and supranationalism. If we want to agree that there's some validity to the new intergovernmentalism, this may be deliberation, but it's in the shadow of Germany. Germany's power of one. This is more of a hard bargaining arena than it is some kind of consensual deliberative body, in the sense that, whose agenda? This is certainly not France's agenda. This was not the agenda of most of Southern Europe. It's Germany. And France is basically nowhere, as Charlemagne in The Economist recently said. And what we see is that it's Germany that pushes ever more stringent numbers and rules. It delays the Greek bailout, and the German Constitutional Court is a constant presence and limit to change. But okay, deliberative body? Well, of course. Deliberative intergovernmentalism, all these member state leaders agree to the rules. So whether you like the rules or not, maybe it is a deliberative body. A deliberative body, yes, in the shadow of Germany, but they all agree, and they all pick up the discourse, and they all say, yes, structural reform. They'll have reasons. There are always reasons for structural reform. Rapid deficit reduction, even as they try to stop going too fast. But also importantly, what you see is over time, you get an important shift. You get a change in the discourse from it's all about stability to actually it's about growth. This starts in 2012. Mario Monti gets appointed as technocratic leader of Italy in place of Berlusconi, and he goes around the capital saying we need growth. And then Hollande, in his campaign discourse, says yes, we need growth, and he wins against Sarkozy. Okay, so what the council does then is start a whole discourse of growth. Not that it does anything for growth, but there's a discourse. And then what happens in 2014? Renzi comes in Italy, and he says, we need flexibility. And then Hollande says, yes, we need flexibility. And even Merkel then says, okay, we'll have flexibility, of course, within the stability rules. But so, I think it's important that what you do get deliberation. This is a deliberative political body. You do get change, at least in the discourse. But actually, this is important. You get increasing politicization, increasing politics, as you get a shift with more center-left politicians coming in. Not that they're actually changing much, but just a little. And yet, this is important for the commission, because what you see is the commission then, slowly but surely, also changes. Future, we'll talk about later. So the commission, so what are they? Are they ayatollahs of austerity or ministers of moderation? I do have to say that I had a research fellowship with the Directorate General of Economics and Finance last year, and in the first presentation of our views, it was 15 fellowships, 14 economists and me, and I was asked to come talk to the Directorate General of Economics and Finance in the Commission about legitimacy, how you build public trust and support for further European economic integration. Well, I had one quick answer: change the policies. But obviously that was not possible, so I did have to write an 80-page paper on this. So if anyone's interested, I can send it to you, but it's also on the EU Commission DG ECFIN website in their economic discussion papers. And anyway, in that first event, I came in and I said, you know, many people say, and they may not be wrong, that you are the ayatollahs of austerity. And everyone laughed, thinking I was joking. But I think importantly, as I spent more time and talked to people and thought about it, actually it's the discourse, it's the public discourse that makes them appear to be ayatollahs of austerity, because what you see over time is incremental change in the rules, a recalibration of the numbers, and in fact that they very much became ministers of moderation, even Olli Rehn. So commission legitimacy we've already talked about. So how do we think about them as ayatollahs of austerity? Well, one thing, their secretariat, they became essentially a secretariat to the council, doing whatever it wanted, an enforcer in the European semester. We don't even want to talk about their role in the Troika, but that's also true of the ECB. In terms of input, what their role is actually undermines national parliamentary legitimacy, because it's the commission that vets national budgets even before national parliaments can look at them. I mean, in terms of a violation, not just of national sovereignty, but the whole, you know, history of parliamentary democracy. This is extraordinary. And yet, all the member state leaders agreed to this. So maybe it is legitimate. And of course, in terms of output, it's ruling by numbers. And here, of course, this is a tremendous problem for different varieties of capitalism, as we know. But I won't go into that here. So that's ayatollahs of austerity. But what about ministers of moderation? What you see is the output policy performance fails. You get increasing flexibility in the excessive deficit procedure. I should just call it the EDP, the MIP. Your excessive deficit procedure or the macroeconomic imbalance procedure, increasing flexibility. What you see is a slowing of deficit reduction and a shift to the push for structural reform. It's really fascinating and boring to look at the annual growth surveys and the country reports, because what you see from 2011 to 2014 is 2011 objective number one, fiscal consolidation. Objective number two, structural reform, which means smash the unions. Objective number three, oh, and by the way, think about unemployment. 2012, 13, 14, fiscal consolidation, number one. Number two, however, structural reform gets more and more interesting. By 2014, in saying, instead of smash the unions, they say, actually, think about talking to the social partners. Find some way to promote growth by, etc. And in the third, it's education, training, research and development, investment. What's fascinating is 2015, number one is no longer fiscal consolidation, it's investment. Number two is still structural reform, but again, it's a much, you know, kinder and gentler structural reform. And at number three, only number three, do you get fiscal responsibility, not consolidation, which is now defined as growth-friendly consolidation, fiscal consolidation. Okay, so they can't get rid of it, but very significant. And what you see as a in all of this is what happens, especially in 2011 and 12, but also in 13 and 14, but less so, is that's the number one message is fiscal consolidation, and that's what governments do. Number three, forget. No one invests in education. No, in fact, they're cutting across the board. They're cutting pensions. They're cutting, you know, education, training, all of that. Are they engaging in structural reform? Where they're engaging in structural reform, it smashed the unions. You see a shift by 2013-14. And you also see, actually, a bit of a shift in the numbers. But it's the 2011-2012 where you see, that's where we see the greatest rise in poverty, et cetera. So I think it's important to see that there is a shift. They're still using the same discourse, the Ayatollah of austerity discourse. But they really have become ministers of moderation. And there's a big shift in 2015 with the Juncker Commission. Future, we'll talk about that later. Parliament, I won't talk about, basically because it had very little role in all of this. So does it remain a talking shop? Is it a potential equal partner? These are the things that we'll want to ask. So concluding substantive questions, you know, it's all about can the EU get the economics right? We're still up in the air about that. Can it get the politics right? We're still up in the air about that. Can it get the governance right? I mean, basically, we need probably major changes there. And in a concluding slide, I'll talk about, I'll just raise those. But in terms of neo-institutional theory, I mean, what you've seen as I've done empirically now is talk about incremental changes over time. Discursive institutionalism, or this, because what I've given you is a discursive institutionalist account, paying attention to ideas and discourse in institutional context, and that institutional context is not only the meaning context, the way in which the institutional actors think about themselves, but it's also the kind of context that the other neo-institutionalists talk about. Preferences matter. It's about North versus South. So you can make this a rational choice institutionalist account of divided preferences or discursive institutional. I mean, they're basically in the same place. Institutions matter. It's about the unanimity rule, the joint decision trap. Power and position matter. And there's a difference between the ECB versus the Commission. ECB autonomy, Commission no. It always has to worry about what the Council is going to say, particularly Schäuble. But there's also a big difference politically between the Council and the European Parliament. The European Parliament, no size at all. The Council, with a lot of size. And of course, ideas and discourse matter for the reinterpretation of the rules and legitimacy. No talk is cheap. So in response to the rational choice institutionalists who say, hey, who cares about ideas and discourse? Talk is cheap. We need to see what, you know, we can attribute interest to all the actors. No, you can't. And basically, discourse matters even when they're lying, and not acknowledging that there are problems. Reinterpreting the rules by stealth leads to suboptimal rules. But at the same time, you can say that not admitting that you're reinterpreting creates space for informal changes that then maybe can be formalized. So this is Adrien Héritier's notion of interstitial processes between formal rules. She does it in terms of rational choice. I'm saying you can do it with ideas and discourse and get deeper grounding. And then we can talk about ideational processes as well of change. And so finally, in the very last slide, toward the future, medium and long term. So is there going to be more fiscal solidarity? Forget Eurobonds. The European Monetary Fund is kind of here already, with the ESM, the European Stability Mechanism. And there's lots of discussion of cyclical adjustment funds, of unemployment funds, with whether this will come into play, perhaps, EU's own resources increasing, and the investment fund is partially that. What about Eurozone rules? There's been talk about this as well, and the unanimity rule have instead supermajorities with opt-outs, and turn the treaties into ordinary legislation. This is Dieter Grimm's argument and others. But basically, if you can amend, you could amend these treaties, then you're not, you know, you're no longer in that joint decision trap, and then you can inject more input legitimacy into the process because there can be parliamentary debates. Even if you don't change the rules, at least they're more seen as more legitimate because parliamentary debates, council debates, that can actually change. And in terms of Eurozone governance, this is a recent idea of mine, you know, there's this enormous budgetary coordination process that's set up where ministries of finance at the national level are connected to DG ECFIN, et cetera. Why not try to think a combination of Germany of the 60s and 70s and France of the 50s and 60s, Germany macroeconomic coordination. In this case, let the ECB set out an inflation target range. Let the Commission say some countries should have it 6% inflation, and others need to have only 2% because of where they are in the cycle. Let this be debated in terms of what the EU should do in any one year by the Council and the European Parliament. Let the Commission be the one making the recommendations, and then have decentralized national European semester councils that are actually nationally owned, as opposed to hierarchical creatures of the Commission, where they act like the French plan in identifying those places where there needs to be investment. A new kind of industrial policy that is not interventionist in the French way, but actually tries to identify, okay, we need more retraining. You know, this is a place where we need to focus our resources, et cetera, so that you could actually have a kind of Eurozone governance in place of governing by the rules and ruling by the numbers. And I'm not going to talk about EU organization. That takes us too far. And I'll stop there.
Thank you very much.